Igual.
To the house where I was.
opposite of Sisera up to me. And the spirit bade me go with him, not with them, go with these six brothers of comfort. And we headed into the man's house. And he showed us how he had seen an angel in the house. He stood and said unto them, send me to Joppa, called the son, whose surname is Peter, who shall tell you whereby you and all your house shall be saved. And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them, as on us at the beginning. Then remember how the word of the Lord, how did he say, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. For as much then as God gave them, to the like gift as he did unto us, who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. What was I that I could withstand God? When they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God, saying then, has God also with his power granted repentance unto life? Now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution of the Lord, Fox Stephen, traveled as far as Cyprus and Cyprus and Antioch, keeping the word of none but the Jews only. And some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which when they were come to Antioch, spoke unto the Jews, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings of these things came of the appearance of the church which was in Jerusalem. And they sent forth Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch, who when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad, and exalted them all that was purpose of heart, being pleased unto the Lord, for he was a good man, and full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And much people were added unto the Lord. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus, but to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. It came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves in the church and taught much people. The disciples were called Christian first in Antioch. And in these days came the prophet from Jerusalem and to Antioch. And that stood up one of them named Agabus. And to signify by the Spirit and them to be a great God throughout all the world, which came to pass in the days of Claudius. Then the disciples, and the man according to his ability, determined to send relief unto the brothers of Judea, which also they did, and sent it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. Amen. Thank God for reading his word, and their blessing unto the hearers. Give honor to the Spirit of Christ to anyone that's here tonight. Thank God for you coming out. Be with us in Bible study tonight, reading the 11th chapter of the book of Acts. Tonight we're talking about the Gentile church. Now that may not sound like much to us today because we see churches of all different race, nationalities, and so a church that's a Gentile today doesn't mean much to us, but you gotta realize the time in which this was done. That was nothing but the Jewish church, and only the Jews believed that God served them only, and them by itself. Nobody else would receive the Holy Ghost but them. Nobody else would be saved but them. Nobody would have God but them. And so today, he probably wasn't really understanding as much as they did back then. But this was a great step in the evangelizing of the world. And so we're going to look at our notes and talking about the Gentile church and say the news that the hated Gentiles were included in the church reached Jerusalem before Peter did. That news sent shockwaves through the Hebrew Christian community. Christianity was not to become merely another sect of Judaism. Had that happened, the Lord Jesus' Great Commission, which would never have been carried out. But like Israel before, the church would not fail to channel the blessings of God's grace and forgiveness to the world. The church outreach for the Gentiles was thus a crucial step in the outworking of God's redemptive plan. That outreach, which began with Peter's ministry to Cornelius and his household, now continued with the founding of the first Gentile church. The gospel was about to take its final step to the remote parts of the earth. Thank God for the believers in Jesus Christ. Didn't act like Israel, the nation did when God called them out. See, God called Israel out to do the same thing that he called the church out to do the thing to Jesus Christ. They were supposed to be a witness to the world. They were supposed to take their knowledge, their belief, and share it with the other nations of the world. But instead of just sharing it with the other nations of the world, they kept it to themselves. They felt like they were the only ones that needed to know about God. So when God came and sent his son, Jesus Christ, and he died, Jesus came up and said, go ye therefore all the world and preach the gospel to every people. He said, baptize them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, he told them, he got up out of the grave and going with back together. He said, preach this gospel to every people. But guess what they did? They went back to Jerusalem, and he told them to wait until they got the Holy Spirit. But they stayed among Jews. They did not go out to anybody else. They didn't go out to preach the gospel to anybody else. They only preached it to the Jews. Because they thought that Christianity or salvation was for the Jews only. Have you ever seen some churches that feel like they're the only one got it? And nobody else got it. God ain't know anything like that. In fact, there's a lot of things that's written in the Word of God that they said God told them not to do. But when you search scripture, you find that God never said that to them. They just with man-made rules and man-made conditions to keep them looking more holy than the other folks would be. But God's always been outreach. He's always been willing to save anybody who believes. And the thing is, remember, when Jesus told them about the neighbor, when he had the leprosy, he said there was a whole lot of people in Israel, the ones under the covenant, that had leprosy. But he said, but the only one got cleansed was a man named Naaman. And he wasn't an Israelite. He wasn't a Jew. He was a Gentile. And yet, God cleansed him of his leprosy and nobody else in Israel. Never had that ever been heard of. But the prophet sent him to the river Jordan to dip himself seven times to the river Jordan, and he shall become king, and he was king. You know what I'm saying? So God, every now and then, you see it in the Old Testament, he reached out to others who were believing. And his own people who knew him would not believe him or not accept him. Those others who didn't know him reached out to him. When they reached out, in fact, in the Bible, you only hear Jesus say, oh, great is God. I have never seen such faith. You know, he only spoke to two people. The two people he spoke to were Gentiles. And the fact of the matter is, he said he hadn't seen that kind of faith nowhere in Israel. Now, they should have been the ones, should have been having this kind of faith. But the fact of the matter is, those people who didn't, they believed. Once they heard it, they accepted it, and they received it. But when the Jews received, because it was for the Jews first, then to the Gentiles. So they had to receive it first. Jesus, when he came, people don't want to receive this, but Jesus actually came for the Jews only. He came for nobody. He came for the seed of Abraham. And that was it. He said that he told him to only go to the lost sheep of Abraham, of Israel. He told him, don't go to the Samaritans, don't go the way of the Gentiles, only go into the lost sheep. And that was it, but that's all he was sent for. He was sent to fulfill the prophecy that was for the children. He said, he was told what the child wants. He said, it ain't good that you give the children meat to the dogs. And she said, well, the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the table. He said, for that saying, the woman brings out there, he heals my daughter because of her sin. But in actuality, when he came, his ministry was for the Jews. But when they rejected him, I thank God, when they rejected him, he turned around to who? To us. And thank God for that. But he knew they weren't going to receive it. You know, sometimes you can be so blessed and don't appreciate how blessed you are until you see somebody else receiving what you should have had. What should have been yours, how you should have been blessed like that. And you see God then turn to them because you said, I don't need God. There's going to be a lot of people shocked. They have the opportunity now to enjoy grace. This is the grace dispensation. This is the grace period. But you know it's going to come to an end. Everything comes to an end. And they're going to be shocked because the door ain't going to be open all the time to the ark. One day that door closed. All right? And the thing is this here. Jesus, he said, I'm not going to stay here always. He said, I got to go away. He said, because if I don't go away, he said, the Holy Spirit came down. One day he had to end and he had to leave this earth. And he left. And you better believe that's going to come a time when he's going to come back and going to do what? Take the church home. All the opportunities that people have right now, get it right. Get in the church. Get them souls saved. That they're going to come and they're going to miss it. And they're going to say, well, what happened to all those people? And the devil going to give them a good excuse to. They get some old kind of magic trick and they just snap them out of it. But the fact of the matter is, all that the Word of God says is true. God told them, he said, look, I want this gospel to go to every creature. And sometimes God has to break down our prejudice. And sometimes we get to a point where we don't want to talk to nobody but our own race, our own kind, people we only like. Anybody different from us, don't talk like us, don't walk like us, don't eat like us, we don't want to have nothing to do with it. And so sometimes God has to break that prejudice out of us. Because let me tell you something, he didn't just save you so you can go to heaven. He saved you so you can go get somebody else. He said, look, I got a feast prepared. And he said, he tell the servant, he said, go out and call all those who was invited first. That was Israel. And now everybody in the Bible said they begin to make excuses. Without man, I brought me two oxen. I got to go cow. Now man, I just bought a field. I got to go see what's like. Well, they gave that kind of excuses. So he said, they're not going to be invited. He said, go out and howl. Hey, howl. Get everybody you can. He said, because I want my house to be filled. You understand? God ain't made heaven for just a one group of people or a certain kind of people. God made heaven for everybody who want to come to his room, enough for everybody. All right? So let's look at our notes. Let's read the first four verses. And it says here in the book of Acts, the 11th chapter, let's read the first four verses. And it says this here. And the apostles and the brothers who was in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also received the word of God. And when Peter was come up to Jerusalem, they were of the circumcision contended with him, saying, you went in to men uncircumcised and did eat with them. But Peter rehearsed the matter from the beginning and expounded it by order of them, saying. Now, it's amazing how fast this news got down to Jerusalem. All right? Peter had went up to Cornelius and preached the gospel to Cornelius and his household. The Holy Spirit fell, everybody got saved. And the word left before Peter left. The Bible said Peter stayed a few more days there. But the word went on back to Jerusalem. All right? So now, look at your notes. That this type of news traveled fast. That the Gentiles had also received the word of God. Consequently, when Peter came up to Jerusalem, those who were circumcised, the Jews, took issue with him, saying, you went to uncircumcised men and ate with them. Many were still zealous for the law and Jewish custom, even though they were believers in Jesus Christ. Such an obvious breach of Jewish custom outraged them. Now, we'll stop right there. Notice, they still holding on to the law. They are believers in Jesus Christ, but they still holding on to their customs. They're still holding on to their beliefs. They're still holding on to their traditions and all their rituals. And they're looking at what Peter did according to the law. And they say, look, you went into men's uncircumcised. In other words, you went into sinners' houses. And you ate with them. And they was upset. They was outraged. How in the world could you eat? How you gonna reach somebody? You going out there, you say go out there and reach the whole world. But how you gonna reach somebody and you sitting up there getting mad because I brought them the gospel? But notice what the first verse said. The first verse said, and the apostles and brothers who was in Judea heard that the Gentiles had what? Received the word of God. They should have been what? Glad. They should have been jumping up and down. Hey, but you know what? Sometimes you can be so in the dark until a floodlight could be hitting you, you don't even know you're in the light. And they couldn't see God because of their tradition, because of their customs, and because of their beliefs. But that prejudice blinds us to God and the things that God is doing in different people's lives. You sometimes you just can't accept it. It's working over there. Those people are actually being blessed. Those people are actually receiving the Holy Ghost. Those people are actually being saved because they didn't get it in your church. Because they didn't get it under your doctor. Because they didn't get it under your preacher. That can't be true. You can be so blind. Prostitutes can come off the street, get saved. Drug addicts can come off the street, get saved. But you're so blind because they didn't come to your doctor. They didn't come to your church. And they didn't come under your preacher. They can't have the Holy Ghost. And that's how they felt right here. That's exactly how they felt. Because they felt like it wasn't David. You know, Jesus had to tell James and John one day. He said, look, we saw a man casting out demons in the name of Jesus. And we forbid him. Because he wasn't with us. He wasn't in our group. And Jesus told him, say, forbid him not. He said, because he that is with me is not against me. He said, so leave him alone. In other words, he ain't hurting us. He ain't helping us. And a lot of things, you don't understand. If he got off drugs, I don't care if he was out there on 9th Street and your church on 5th Street, but he got off drugs on 9th Street, you ought to be praising God. But instead, you said, ain't nobody get saved on 9th Street. But ain't nothing up there on 9th Street like us. But see, the thing is, this is what they were coming to Peter. They said, Peter, you ain't no business going to these people's house. Not that they had received the word. They heard. They've been saved. They've been filled with the Holy Ghost. They had accepted the gospel. They all that went across their head. All they saw was Peter walking into these people's houses. And they was Gentile. And he was a Jew. And they were really upset with him. And like I say, many were still zealous for the law and Jewish custom. Even though they were believers in Jesus Christ, such an obvious breach of the Jewish custom outraged them. Acknowledging that Jesus was their Messiah and Lord was one thing. Accepting that he was equally the Lord of the Gentile was enough. You understand? He is the Savior. He is the Messiah. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. And he's nobody else. See how their minds are? Now, it said, no, there is nothing. This is what I want you to know. There is nothing in the law of Moses which forbid eating with Gentiles. This was an addition made by man, not God. Every time you read that, it says, well, I never really did the research on it. Then I found out, that thing comes from God. That's still man's made rules. God never did tell us they couldn't do that. Like God told them, invite a man, teach him. And everything, what you believe, so they'll learn to like you and know the God that you know. But they, in their prejudice, made the law that, you know, I guess they figured y'all stuff. That was time when blacks and whites didn't go in the same places. Because you were black, you had to go over here. Because I'm white, I go over here. All that's man-made. You understand? Ain't nothing different. You cut it. I guarantee you he'll be ready. Huh? Just like you. And he'll get sick like you. And he'll die just like anybody else. You understand? But the thing is this. Men make difference. They try to separate. God ain't got a way. Alright? But now. But Peter rehearsed the matter from the beginning. Instead of entering into a heated rebuke of their prejudice, Peter certainly recounted the remarkable event leading to the Gentile conversion. Now, I'm not going to read over that, but the fact of the matter is, he told them the whole story of what happened. Now, that was wise. Because he could have got out there and said, you know God told us to go to everybody else, but he didn't. He told them exactly what happened. You understand? I'll tell you something. Can't nobody take your experience away. The blind man that was born blind, and they told him, he said, look, go get his parents. We don't believe him. The man said, well, they said, look, we know this man did something violating the Sabbath.
He healed you on the Sabbath day. And Lord, you know, say that was wrong with you and nobody. Or these are all man-made rules. But Jesus made some mud, put a man out, and the man came back seeing. And he didn't even know who Jesus was, didn't know what Jesus looked like, anything. And they just said to him, they said, look at that man. That man's a sinner. We know God. We know God with Moses. But this man, we don't know where he comes from. And the blind man said, he said, look, I don't know this stuff. I don't know the theology you guys teach. I don't know nothing about y'all beliefs and all this stuff. But he said, but this one thing I do know. And he said, can't nobody take that away from me. He said, I know I was blind. This one thing I know. I was born blind. My mom and dad told me I was blind, and I ain't never saw light before. But when this man put mud on my eyes, told me to go wash, he said, I came back and I was sick. Now, that's something they can't change. That's something you can't take away. You know what I'm saying? Your experience, people might say, you ain't saved, but you know you saved. People might say, you ain't got, you know you got the Holy Ghost. Because why? Your experience can't nobody take that away from you. Peter started telling them about his experience. He ain't trying to tell them what was right and what was wrong. He just trying to tell them what he experienced. He said, look, this is what happened. All right? Now, look at this. Go down to the 17th verse of that 11th chapter. And look what he said. This is Peter wrapping up the whole story after he rehearsed everything that had happened and what had taken place. Look at verse 17. This is the answer to all their dispute. He said, for as much then as God gave them, notice what he said, them, the Gentiles, the light gift, in other words, salvation by faith, he said, through grace, as he did unto us, who believed on the law of what? Jesus Christ, that's the requirement, what was I that I could withstand God? Now, Peter wrapped up the whole thing like this here. He said, Peter wrapped up his summary with this pointed observation that if God therefore gave to them the same gift as what he gave to us, also after believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in the way of God? In other words, we got it that way. And see, God did it that way on purpose. Because he knew their presence. He knew their beliefs. He knew how they looked at things. And so God did the exact same way he did for them. In other words, the day of Pentecost, he did it the same way in Cornelius' house. So that they couldn't doubt it, they couldn't question it, because they got to say, he got it just like we got it. The same way we received it, the way we were sitting, hearing the word. In fact, the Bible said they were just sitting. And all of a sudden, a mighty rush of wind came into the room and filled them with the Holy Ghost. Peter was just up preaching. They was, the Gentile was just what? Sit. God did it exactly the same. So Peter said, look, God did it for them the same way he did it for us. Now, who am I to stop God's work? You understand? People try to stop God's work with their own man-made tradition, their own man-made, but you can't stop God's work because you don't want to go along with it. God gonna still work that way. God gonna still do what you want to do. And you can't stop it. Bible said, if God be for us, who can be against us? Peter said, this is, summarize it up. They got it the same way that we got it on the day of Pentecost. And he said, now, God was showing them that you are no different than the Gentiles. We are both the same. So look at verse 18. He said, when they heard these things, talk about those who contended against me, he said, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath, this is why I tell people, you can't use Acts as a book of doctrine. Because notice, this is news to them. It says, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. They didn't think nobody else was supposed to see this, but the Jews. They were shocked that Gentiles got saved. So, you see, the book of Acts is a book of transitions. And that's why you just can't stop on one point. It's moving. It's changing. It's totally going up forward. All right? So look at the notes in verse 18. They say, when Peter's accuser heard this, they quieted down. They could hardly argue with what? The Holy Spirit Peter said, these brothers, these six brothers plus me, the seven witnesses, all the scripture, because he preached the word of God. He said, they would come to that mission that God had granted to the Gentiles, also the repentance that leads to life. But until the Hebrew Christian came to that realization, they would never begin the task of evangelizing the Gentiles. This proclaimed in no uncertain terms that they were given such life strictly on faith, which included none of the rituals or ceremonies or Judaism. They didn't go to the priest. They didn't bring no cow. They didn't bring no sheep. They didn't bring no offering. It was in a house, in a Gentile, sitting in a chair. And Peter was up preaching. And all people doing preaching about Jesus. While they were sitting there waiting for the word that Peter was supposed to bring to them, God sent the Holy Ghost right down upon them. Now, they couldn't argue with them. Because another thing you got to understand is here. They didn't know nothing about baptism in Jesus' name, so they weren't baptized. They didn't know nothing about repentance until Peter brought it to them. Repentance under Jesus Christ. They didn't know nothing about faith until Peter brought it to them. But while they were sitting there, just sitting, listening to the word, just like they were sitting on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit fell on them. And so they said, look, they didn't come to the Jews. They didn't follow our traditions. They didn't follow our rituals. They didn't do none of the things that we did. And yet God saved them. In spite of all those things. You see, the only thing that saved you is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. All this other stuff, people say you got to jump over five benches and you got to roll over 15 times. Ain't got nothing to do with being saved. All the thing that saves you is faith in Jesus Christ. When you put your faith in him and him alone and what he did for you, died on the cross for your sin, how he died, was buried, and rose again. When you put your faith in that, that's all it takes. All this other stuff that people throw in there, add in there, you know. I often say to a person one time, I thank God. God didn't leave it up to you. And tell you, look, except you be without sin, you can't go to heaven. All of us would have been lost. Because none of us make that command. That's why we are not going on our own righteousness. We're going on his righteousness. His righteousness was perfect. The Bible says he took my place, I took his place. His righteousness was given unto me. My sin was placed on him. You understand? And it's because of that we can walk into heaven, walk in front of God, come boldly before the throne of grace, because we are saved. Somebody say, what did justified just as if you had never sinned? And somebody say, what did you just as if you had that's what it means. Because if you got any sin, God won't let you in. Plain and simple as that. 1 ounce, one mark, one scratch will keep you out. God can't stand sin in no form or fashion. So the only way you're going to get in is through what Jesus did. Believe it on him, put all your faith in him. And once you believe that, then God will accept it. But that takes away all man, puts all faith in God. Ain't what you do is who you believe. When you believe him, you will do what's right because of what? Your faith in him. Let's look at verse 19. It says, now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about scattered, traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word, notice what it says, preaching the word to what? To none but unto Jews only. I'm only going to preach to my brothers and my sisters, my cousins, my aunts, and my aunts. That's all I'm going to preach to. I'm only going to preach to blacks, Haitians, Jamaicans. I ain't preaching to nobody else. Huh? They ain't preaching to nobody but their own kind. You understand? The gospel was for everybody. Now, this package picks up where chapter 84 left off, discussing the effects of the persecution that arose in connection with that. But note this thing. Wherever they went, the refugees from Jerusalem was speaking the word to no one except the Jews only. Basically, they were proclaiming that Jesus was the Messiah of Israel and the Savior of the world, and that he had risen from the dead. They was preaching the kingdom gospel. They was preaching about the Messiah coming and ruling again, sitting on the throne, what he's going to do in the millennial time. They was preaching that. They were preaching that Jesus was the Messiah, that Jesus was the Savior of the world, and that Jesus did rise from the dead. But that's the kingdom gospel. He said, they could not have known that the gospel had spread to the Gentiles since they fled Jerusalem before that happened. They still assumed the gospel was for the Jewish people alone. You know, sometimes we can't be in the dark about that. That's why God always teased us so much at a time. He could have given them this all right there on the day of Pentecost. He could have, but they wasn't ready. See, Paul says something in the book of Hebrews. He said, for the time, he said, well, you ought to be teachers. You have that you be taught again, which be the first person. He said, I fed you with milk and not with meat. He said, because here of you were you not able to receive it. Something was choking you and you feel it. They can't accept it. Notice, the Jews, they accepted Jesus as the Messiah. They accepted him as the Savior of the world. They accepted that he had rose from the dead, but they did not accept that anybody else was going to be saved but the Jews. And that thing was hard for them to swallow. They couldn't accept that. You never find in the Word where Peter, John, and James ever went out to Gentiles. It was Paul. That's why Jesus called Paul the apostle of the Gentiles, because that's what he was going to say too. Peter the one, in fact, in the book of Galatians, Peter gave Paul and them the hand, the right hand of fellowship, said, y'all go unto the Gentiles, and we'll go unto the Jews. They still had that in them. And so the thing is, God getting ready to move on. The thing is, God ain't gonna let that, some folks say, God ain't gonna let one monkey stop, don't you? He gonna keep that thing moving. And the thing is, the word got to get out. And if you don't want to go, somebody says, you don't get on this train, don't stop me. I'm going on. You understand? It ain't no time. We only got a short time to be here. Fooling with a lot of these man-made rules, these man-made traditions gonna cause a lot of people to go to here. Because they say, leave, I go back to church, they're gonna make me do this, they're gonna make me do that, they're gonna make me do this. Not knowing that they ain't none, they got nothing to do with salvation. But in their mind, they've been told that so much that they believe that to the point where they just don't want to accept it. The fact of the matter is, gospel is free. None of your works can get you in. Only thing gonna get you in is salvation. You see, I often tell people, you get to a point where you're gonna run into somebody who's on his last leg, but he wanna be saved. He don't want to go ahead. But he can't get up and call Jesus on the altar. He can't go out there and get baptized in Jesus' name. He's on the bed of death, but he don't want to go ahead. He don't want to go to heaven. Now, what you going to say to him as a child of God? Oh, you had all your time, man. You should have used it more power. That's what you could tell him. But right now, his heart is just like the thief on the cross. He know he getting ready to die, but he don't want to go to heaven. I done ran into a lot of hospital beds. People's on their last leg. I ain't even like that. But I know all it takes is faith in Jesus and what he needs. You understand? Because that's all it's going to save you. You believe what Jesus did, he'll save you. No matter how much you done did. God, this is the thing people don't understand. God forgave you of all your sins. And some of us did more sins than some of the people on their death did. But God forgave you of all your sins. And the thing is this here. He ain't willing, the Bible says he ain't willing that any should perish. And if God would send his son to die for this wicked world, you think he gonna let somebody just go to hell just because you say, well, he didn't come to my church, so he gonna go to hell? God gonna call you into judgment for the very words that you said. Because if you, just like the Jews, like it right here, they don't want to go to God because they ain't of their race. Brother, the gospel is free, and it's for everybody. And everybody gets saved the same way. Nobody gets different. People kind of make things different to make themselves seem super holy, seem super religious. But this thing is too simple. You look super stupid because what you do things that's not called for. I mean, you go out, you do all this stuff, you go out in the mountains and get away from everybody, and you could have fun. Could have been around everybody. Could have been eating breakfast at McDonald's, huh? But no, I don't want to eat McDonald's, but all them settlers at McDonald's. Well, that's you. You know what I'm saying? Call all those headaches for this. You know what I'm saying? This is a life to be enjoyed. Jesus said, I come that you might have life. Not sadness, huh? Not all dysfunctional, you know, but that you might have life and that you might have it more abundant. So now look at verse 20 and 21. You see, the thing is, when you tell people that, they get mad with you. But the fact of the matter is, what are you going to do with that person in that hospital that's dying? Are you going to tell him, well, man, you went too late. You're going to hell. Just going to hell. That's what you're going to tell him? When he called you and said he wanted to be saved, that's what you're going to tell him? Too late, man. You like, they got that. You can't call Jesus and not me. No. That was required. That was man-made. But the fact of the matter, what is required is faith. That's the